What's up, guys? Darius Cousin here, and I just want to quickly say before we start this Vlogs on Launch episode that I do have a second channel here on YouTube that I would love for you to check out. It's a lot more personal, it's a lot more about me than it is about history, but nonetheless, I would love it. I would really appreciate it if you could give it just a little bit of time and just check it out. The link is in the description. And with that being said, we can now continue with your regularly scheduled Vlog of Knowledge. Women belong to the highest bidder. Power is what they like. It is the greatest of aphrodisiacs. As for me, I take them and forget them. This remark was made by Napoleon Bonaparte to one of his assistants during his exile on the island of St. Helena. It shouldn't surprise you that the original hard man of Europe solidified his tough guy image by denigrating the women in his life and stripping them of their influence. Napoleon was a man of many talents. As any great general, he led his armies to victory multiple times. But he was also known to be a womanizer, with a certain taste for the fine woman of post-revolutionary France. And just like war, sex has many risks. Today, I want to ask and answer this one simple question. Did Napoleon have STDs? But before we get to that question, as always, let's put all this in historical context and get some background so that you guys can have all the information to understand this video. We're going to start with Napoleon, his story, because some of you may not know his story, and then we'll circle back and see whether or not this great general had STDs. If you're new here, I'm Darius Cousin and this is Vlogs on Knowledge. Make sure to subscribe, make sure to hit the notification bell because we do have brand new episodes every single week. Napoleon Bonaparte, also known as Napoleon I, was a French military leader and emperor who conquered much of Europe in the early 19th century. Born on the island of Corsica, Napoleon rapidly rose to the ranks of the military during the French Revolution. As a boy, Napoleon attended school in mainland France where he learned the French language and eventually went on to graduate from the military academy in 1785. And it wasn't too long before the French Revolution began in 1789, and within 3 years, revolutionaries had overthrown the monarchy and proclaimed a new French Republic. However, Napoleon was away from France for much of that time. He was mostly inactive during the early days of the revolution, spending most of his time at home on the island of Corsica. Following a clash with political figures, the Napoleon family was forced to leave and head to France, where Napoleon resumed his military duties. During that time, Napoleon associated with the right people and quickly became an important member of the military. In 1795, he was promoted to Major General. The French Revolution was a very disruptive time for France, to say the least. I mean, they had overthrown the king, installed a new government, and were constantly in political instability. And this gave Napoleon plenty of battles to prove himself as a general. Out of the many enemies of France, England was proving to be a difficult one. Napoleon was given a chance to lead an invasion against England, but he decided that France's navy was not yet ready to face off the British naval forces, so he resorted to instead attack Egypt, a trading partner for England. Napoleon, being the great general that he was, had absolutely no trouble winning against the Egyptians. He was the better general and he had the better army. Unfortunately, however, the British didn't take too long to retaliate and they ended up wiping out Napoleon's fleet not too long after. Napoleon's army was then stuck in Egypt with no way out. That summer, with the political situation in France still marked by uncertainty, the ambitious and the great general that was Napoleon opted to abandon his army in Egypt and return to France. Napoleon then organized a coup d'etat and replaced the government with his own three-member consulate, where he was the first consul. This effectively made him the most powerful man in France, and 5 years later, in 1804, he crowned himself Emperor of France in a lavish ceremony at the Cathedral of Notre Dame in Paris. What follows is about 11 years of war and conquest that we now call the Napoleonic Wars. During that time, Napoleon won many battles, expanded France's influence greatly, and brought forth reforms that would benefit the country for years to come. Unfortunately, as I always say on this show, nothing lasts forever. As great of a general as Napoleon was, he was bound to start losing battles at some point. And it started with the Russians, who adopted a strategy to retreat their armies as Napoleon was invading Russia, and then attacking him when he least expected. Then he lost to the various coalitions formed by other countries like England, Austria, Spain, Portugal, that all ganged up on France. I mean, France had just overthrown their king and the monarchy. The other countries didn't really like that and they were kind of afraid of the French Revolution influencing their own people to possibly overthrow their own monarchies. In 1814, the coalition successfully entered France and forced Napoleon to give up the throne. He was then exiled to a small island in Italy where he was given sovereignty over the entire island. Napoleon, unsatisfied with his loss, I mean who would be happy going from an emperor to being a nobody, escapes the island and attempts to take back the power that he once had. He goes back to France, gathers an army, and begins what we now call the 100 Days Campaign, where he tries to win over France for the last time. He is unsuccessful and exiled once again, this time on a remote island in the Atlantic Ocean, where he died 6 years later at the age of 51. The cause of his death is not sure. There are multiple theories, but not one of them can be confirmed with 100% certainty. And this is because the doctors of the time weren't thorough enough and did not know as much about medicine as we know today. The leading theory on his death is that he probably had gastric cancer, which he may have gotten from his dad. Another theory is that he was poisoned with arsenic by the British, or that he might have died from syphilis, a sexually transmitted disease. Which, of course, brings me back to the original question of this video. Did Napoleon have STDs? Well, to answer that question, let's look at Napoleon in more details. Napoleon wasn't the prettiest of generals. He was short, he was pale, and he did not have an attractive face. When he was a kid, he was painfully aware that he wasn't attractive and resented those men who had all the luck. Naturally, he grew up envious of women and angry with the fact that he did not win the genetic lottery. Perhaps this is why he became such a great general in the first place, to fill that void of not being enough for women. On the other hand, as Napoleon was growing up, France was in a sort of interesting period. They already had a reputation of being sexually open, but now the church had lost a lot of its influence, so this was accentuated even more. France was the place for sex. As the revolution was progressing, Napoleon was getting more and more status amongst the military ranks, and when he eventually became general, he suddenly found himself to be desirable to other women. I mean, after all, women are attracted to power and men are attracted to women. So Napoleon, with his difficult past, he was finally able to get the object of his desires. He was finally able to get the woman that he so longed for all of his life. I think you can now imagine where this is going to go. Napoleon took a wife and fell madly in love with her. During his invasion of Egypt, he wrote her long letters of love. She retaliated by having an affair. Napoleon, angry, takes the first Egyptian girl that he sees as a mistress. But the Egyptian government doesn't like this, so they behead the girl. Poor Napoleon now doesn't have a mistress, but it's okay, he didn't suffer long. He quickly sent off one of his soldiers home and took his wife instead. From then on, Napoleon saw women as spoils of war, having brief affairs, as brief as 3 minutes by some accounts, with women as he campaigned and ruled. They included actresses, an Italian opera singer, a duchess, a bedchamber maid, and so on. His behavior ranged from seductively charming to misogynistic, depending on his mood. He eventually divorced Josephine and remarried a different woman to father and heir to the throne. Meanwhile, in France, the divorce rate was really high and 1/3 of all children were born outside of a marriage. The country was also known for an outbreak of STDs, more specifically syphilis, that happened a few centuries earlier. And with Napoleon's wild sexual adventures, it seems to point that he quite possibly could have had syphilis. However, the autopsy report of Napoleon's body indicates a different story, gastric cancer, which evidence tells us he may have gotten it from his dad, because his dad died of a similar cancer. Unfortunately, no autopsy was done on any other family members, so the evidence is kind of limited. The autopsy report also found high contents of arsenic in his hair, which may indicate he was either poisoned by the British, or he was trying to self-medicate using arsenic to treat syphilis. But this is debatable, because the main treatment for syphilis at the time was mercury rather than arsenic. Later studies have demonstrated that the arsenic could have come from the wallpaper in his house when he was exiled, since back then it was common to have wallpapers that contained arsenic. When they eventually tested the walls of that same house, they found contents of arsenic in them. I'm afraid to say that I can't really give you a guaranteed answer to this video. We don't know if Napoleon had syphilis or not. We can only speculate based on his lifestyle and the woman that he's been with. And while his death may not have been caused by the disease itself, it's still highly probable that he had it at one point in his life. And with that, I want to pass the question on to you guys. Do you guys think that Napoleon has syphilis or any other STDs? Please do leave me a comment, I would love to read and answer them all. And bonus points for you, as always, if you do leave a comment, you get a chance to be featured in next week's video as a fan of the week. And before we finish this video, I just want to say one thing. I haven't covered the story of Napoleon completely. I've only brushed the surface of everything that is to know about Napoleon. That's okay. I'm actually doing this on purpose because I want you guys to go out and research more on your own. Because I believe in getting you guys educated, and it's the reason why I do this channel. I give you guys enough information to get you curious about a subject, so then you can go out and research more on your own. And if you want to do that, as always, there's some links in the description where you can start. Thank you so much for watching the video. If you've enjoyed it, it would mean the world to me if you left a like, subscribed, and hit that notification bell. You would join Team Knowledge, and I'll be very happy to have you on board. And with that being said, my name has been Darius, and it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for watching the video once again, and I will see you all next week.